Welcome to the Kaz and Brew Show.
Yeah.
What is up, brother Kaz? I gotta say, it's been 2 weeks. I needed my Kaz fix.
I know.
What the hell? No Kaz and Brew Show for a week?
Crazy.
We don't even notify our listeners.
I know.
We're terrible,
yeah.
I will blame Stat Boy for that.
Sure. He was supposed to send out that tweet, so.
And he didn't.
Typical Stat Boy.
Typical Stat Boy. 2 weeks off. But this is the time of the year that we, you know, we only recharge our engines like once every year. Maybe twice. Maybe we once had an episode that we didn't put out because maybe we partied the night before.
Maybe. We're just, you know, that possibly happens. But in general.
But by and large, we're on every week.
We don't want you all to do without, so we sacrifice and make this thing happen every week.
I'm doing it for the children.
Of course.
I'm setting an example.
They are the future.
That is the children. I do believe that the children are the future. You teach them well, you let them lead the way.
Let them lead the way.
And show them all the beauty they have inside.
Yes.
I don't know why I know those words. Actually, I do know why I know those words.
Was it the talent show?
I think once I might have sang that song to a large group of people.
We did indeed.
Those were the days. And so these days in the world of basketball, not a ton is happening. Nope. We're getting lower level news items like Ty Lawson to the Kings.
Oh, snap.
Does this change your opinion
on
the Kings?
The Ty Lawson era has begun.
Are you now a Kings fan?
I think I'm all in.
That's just such a Kingsy move to make.
They need some players over there, though.
They do need a backup.
If he comes motivated, he could do some nice things.
It's just the reason why it's Kingsy is you've got Darren Collison, who will be suspended for some amount of games for domestic violence. And then you get, you know, Ty Lawson, who had been arrested for domestic violence. And that was a while back.
That's right. I was just thinking about the DUI stuff. I forgot about the domestic violence.
He and his girlfriend both got arrested. I can't remember a lot about this story. Yeah. But the DUIs are the ones that are most recent. And that's, you know, this is not a good look, and you know you hear him in the press, you see his articles, and it doesn't sound like a guy that might have turned over new leaf.
Yeah.
So we're going to find out. Nobody in the NBA touches him with a 10-foot pole, I'm guessing
that they don't have a lot of confidence.
There you go.
Yeah.
So we're getting that level of news. This is a big football weekend. I had my fantasy football draft.
I know. I think mine's tonight. My commissioner isn't getting back to me. I think he's trying to do me in here.
Trying to freeze you out?
Trying to freeze me out.
I went into the draft having done zero studying.
Yes.
I used Evan Silva's rankings over at RotoWorld.
Okay.
So he's like, I do the Brewski 150. We're actually going to talk some. Kaz is going to talk fantasy today.
Talk some fantasy today. Boy.
He says that he's going to talk some fantasy. I don't believe it because a lot of caffeine in me. We tried to do a fantasy segment like 2 years ago or a year ago.
That was a different time and a different place.
And Kaz was all for it. And then halfway through every fantasy segment, which he would be hosting, he would fall asleep.
I would not fall asleep.
It made me feel like the worst.
Some people.
Number two chair ever.
I was not falling asleep. Sometimes I listen.
Dude, you snored during one. We had to remove the snore
sometimes.
Sound from a podcast.
I listen sometimes with my eyelids very close when I'm really concentrating, and I snore. The snore is not a snore, it's just a deep breathing that helps me focus on what's being said.
You need to see somebody for that sleep apnea problem. Yeah, so we're going to try some fantasy talk in a little bit, because over at hoop-ball.com, we released our fantasy draft guide. And this is something that's near and dear to me, because I've been putting that together over at RotoWorld for like 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great product over there, but I feel like we have a lot of guys now on the HoopBall team. So we're good, solid, almost 10 deep.
Nice.
With guys that are pretty deadly in the world of fantasy. And so when you have that many contributors, we've been able to release our guide. And I would say we probably have maybe a quarter of the content, maybe half of the content out. So this thing is not even close to finished. And it's already awesome.
Nice.
And so we've been selling that $9.99 for a limited time.
For a limited time.
Just a limited time.
Get on it, guys. Get on it. Don't miss out. Get the leg up on.
I went to my fantasy football draft with the football equivalent of the Brewski 150, which is done by Evan Silva over at RotoWorld, who I basically trust my fantasy life with. It's nice. He's the best in the business. Him and Adam Levitan, Pat Daugherty, those guys put together some great stuff over there at rotoworld.com, my old stomping grounds. So I went to the draft, 9:30 start time, a.m., Bloody Marys,
mm-hmm.
and people were dancing by halfway through the draft.
Nice.
It was on.
It was a good time.
So I'm sure you guys have done something like that yourselves there in the listenership.
I'm not really.
Are you fired up for the football season?
Well, my Raiders look pretty decent. They should be knocking on the door of a playoff. They got talent there. They had a nice off season. They actually were able to get free agents that are in their prime as opposed to being like the last stop before the graveyard. So
are we going to get through this without talking about Colin Kaepernick?
I don't think so. I don't know that we can.
I don't think we can.
I don't think we can.
This has been I did not see coming. No, obviously nobody saw it coming. I don't even know if Colin Kaepernick saw this coming.
Isn't it Kaepernick?
I don't know.
It's Kaepernick.
It's Kaepernick.
Okay. But anyway, continue.
Colin Kaepernick.
Cap. Yeah,
I guess set it up first. He refused to stand for the national anthem.
Yes.
Because he will not support a nation that oppresses people of color.
Yes.
And then he mentioned the police.
Yes.
And the paid time off, and I should probably be reading a quote.
Yeah.
So I'm not air quoting
something
this.
To the effect of, there's bodies on the street, and people are getting
murdered.
Paid leave for murder.
Yes.
Yes.
Precise terms.
Yeah.
And really out of left field. And Tim Kawakami of the San Jose Mercury News, I would recommend following him because he kind of knows the inner workings of the Niners as well as anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And he described it as you could sense something was coming
mm-hmm.
because the PR guy came rushing in.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody out there, and I think it might have been Pro Football Talk, noticed that he sat during the anthem.
Okay.
And he'd been doing that for a couple of weeks, but not in his uniform. So apparently there was a delineation that if you're not in a football uniform, that it's somehow okay to sit
versus
being in a uniform. But when he was in a uniform and he sat, then that got attention.
Yeah.
And so you could tell that Kaepernick was, according to Kawakami, almost welcoming the discussion.
Yes.
When the PR guy came out, he came out smiling, and then he was asked if he should go to the podium where they do the bigger press conferences mm-hmm. or if they wanted to have a gaggle around the locker room. And they chose they call it the theater, where they do the bigger press conferences.
Yeah, okay.
So kind of unplanned,
all
this stuff.
Yeah.
But Kaepernick was fine with it. He's welcoming this, and this is a career changing.
Yeah.
Like, you go from being discussed in football circles to now you're a topic all around the nation.
Yeah.
It was a topic all around our fantasy football league.
Yeah.
And so, to me, aside from, I'm not 100% sure Kaepernick wanted this to go public.
I don't know. He made some comments the next day or yesterday after like a practice or something. It's clearly something that he wanted to do. He's clearly, this is an issue that has touched him, and it's, he's thought about this. It doesn't strike me as like a seat of your pants type of thing. I think he was waiting for this to happen and waiting.
But wasn't maybe specifically sure it'd be this moment.
No, I don't know that.
Like, he was ready in his mind for this to happen.
Yes.
Like, he knew the consequences could hit him at some point, mm-hmm. but he didn't know when.
Right.
And that, to me, I guess that doesn't necessarily indicate that he's unprepared.
Right.
It just opens the door in my mind for whether or not he was fully prepared for the moment itself, how big it would become. He seems prepared,
mm-hmm.
but I'm not 100% sure he's prepared.
Yeah, because I heard about it very late. Because I even watched when I watched ESPN and they were going over the game, and they hadn't known about it yet, really, because all they talked about was that how he did in the offense. Like, there was even a breakdown by Merrill Hodge, and he was talking about, well, he didn't see this guy, and Chip Kelly is obviously he's a guy. They never brought up. So this was it. I must have, like, just glanced, something popped up on whatever, like maybe one in the morning for me.
Yeah, it was about hour after the game that I think the first PR request came in to talk to Cap on this issue. Okay. And that, what I believe, was from Pro Football Talk. So it did all happen late.
Yeah.
This was one of those things where social media and the availability of media kind of, I think, sped the situation up.
Sure. Yeah.
And then it just hit.
Yeah.
And it was like, boom.
I do remember looking at it and going, as I was going to bed, going like, this is going to get interesting in the morning.
Well, you're right. And it's become interesting, I almost think, more because of people's reactions to the situation.
Yes.
And I get a little bit irked on this because I feel like it's a pretty simple thought exercise here, folks. Like, this is a pretty simple thought exercise. Do you believe in the First Amendment?
Yeah, I do.
So then there you go. Yeah. I mean, that's and really nothing else comes into play.
Yeah.
And you can disagree with his stance.
Sure.
That's fine.
Absolutely.
But
First Amendment.
I know. People talking about how somehow his employment status.
Oh, God.
Indicates and how much money he has earned,
right?
And how that somehow diminishes his ability to speak out on a topic.
That's comical.
It's something where you can disagree with the way that he expressed himself.
Absolutely.
You can disagree with his inability to delineate the difference between military and this and that and the great things that America is and then the bad things that America also is.
Yes.
And you can take those individual situations and you could give them their each appropriate due.
Yeah.
But that's not happening out there. And you saw, even at like newspapers, I saw Jason Jones, who happens to be black, and his white colleagues have differences of opinion. And it's right down the middle on this story.
Yeah.
You see these differences of opinions out there, but I just wonder, like, I don't think that Kaepernick should have been so brash about, like, avoiding talking about the great things America does. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think he should omit that. I think he should offer a more balanced view, but I don't disagree with anything that he did, and I don't really disagree with what he said.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm okay with that.
Yeah, I understand. Like, my initial thing in the morning, as like the everyone's getting riled up, my thinking was, you know, immediately you can see that the actual topic was not going to be an issue. The issue was going to be the protest and the national anthem and sitting. That was going to be all that anyone talked about, and that concerned me, like you said about the being prepared, that concerned me because this is such an important issue.
And do you want him to become the leader of it?
Do you want him to become the leader of it? And will it really be talked about? Because it's just not being talked about. All they're talking about is he disrespectful? The actual heart of the issue that has moved him is being put on the back burner now. I don't know that that's necessarily his fault, because I think that there's a lot of people out there that don't want to talk about this issue and are glad to have
the football to discuss
a reason to, you know, talking about the anthem and him standing or sitting doesn't move that conversation forward. And there's a lot of people that are fine with that. But I'm a First Amendment to the end person.
You have to be.
You know, I don't think when people want to stop the skinheads or the KKK from marching, I am not for that. I want them out there spewing their stupid stuff so everyone can hear exactly
how dumb
they are. I just that's just my belief.
But it's the core of a free civilization.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to be able to speak your mind.
Right.
And I just find it so interesting that there's a large portion of, say, Donald Trump supporters out there that love him for his off the cuff,
right.
His, you know, his lack of political correctness.
Sure.
And I wonder how many of them are criticizing, you know, Colin Kaepernick Kaepernick.
Now he's Colin.
Somebody else did that to me. Somebody else was calling him Colin.
Yeah.
It's more than one thing can be true at the same time, people.
Sure.
It's just a thought exercise that's gone awry.
Yeah. I also wonder, you know, like the stuff about how much money he makes, I thought people bringing that up, I thought that's interesting because, like, if you look at a lot of the plights of people, not only in America, but around the world, if people that weren't affected by it never spoke up and did anything, a lot of things wouldn't get done. Like the women that were at the front of the suffrage movement and stuff like that, a lot of those individual women, their lives were okay as far as women in that time went. You know, they didn't have to take on that burden, but they did. You know, like Gandhi was a lawyer. He didn't have to become the forefront of the revolution and lead people that, you know, his life wasn't being affected for the people that he was fighting for. And so that is, to me, like the silliest of arguments. Oh, he makes a lot of money. It's not even about him.
What we have to do, because I see a lot of this happening right now. You got Gabby Douglas, is it, from the Olympics?
Yes.
You got the same exact topic, practically.
Right.
Has happened here. And with the rhetoric on many different sides, but in general, the rhetoric that's out there right now, it feels like, I said to you, I thought it was getting a chance that it might be getting better. Mm-hmm. Like, to immediately retract that right. statement and call myself an idiot.
Right.
Because I don't think it's getting better. And
she was just standing there just because she didn't have her hand over her heart.
I feel like we're at a pivotal time where the smart people have to speak up and say, like, we have to be able to identify both the good and the bad in each situation that's out there and be very specific about what we're talking about, because the minute we dumb this conversation down, we start building, you know, these massive spaces between people.
Right.
And it's about bringing people together.
Absolutely.
And not this divisiveness that's out there that's really created by a lack of thinking. You just, to get to point B on these concepts, you just have to think it through.
Yeah. You think, like, there's these kind of symbolic ideals of patriotism in our country that are, like, for me, like, speaking out on an issue against government, especially for people that don't have a voice, to me, that is one of the most patriotic things you can do. But there is, like, this thing of, like, if you just, like, have a flag on your car and, you know, you're listening to your Toby Keith records or whatever, that somehow, like, that's being a true patriot. Like, what if Kaepernick said, I'm not going to stand because in America, a woman gets sexually assaulted every 5 minutes.
Right.
Would there be this blowback? Would people say, like,
if
he said, like, oh, you know, well, you know, if you steal a car, you get a longer jail sentence than someone who molests a child. So I'm going to sit down. Would people still be this upset about it? Like, so people got to think about the bigger picture sometime. If it's really that act of just sitting, that's outraging you. You just do the experiment. Just plug in something else that maybe isn't.
Yeah, it's like algebra. You just plug in a different variable.
A different variable that maybe isn't as divisive, and ask yourself, would you really be that upset that he sat if that was the reason why? You know, and I think a lot of people aren't really doing that, I think.
No, they're not. And it's stoked by large media voices that I think you just have to take a step back and try to think this stuff through. The media is, I don't know why they're not doing that, but they don't. I think maybe it's ratings.
It's most of what they do.
And really, you know, we're probably getting outside the scope. We're definitely outside the scope of basketball, but
sure.
I mean, you know what? There's nothing going on in the league.
Yeah.
And this is a bigger deal. And this, I think, is what people were talking about. I went to my fantasy football draft. People were bagging on Colin Kaepernick. And that's fine. You know, that's your opinion, and that's great. And,
absolutely.
You know, that doesn't mean if I disagree with that I'm anti-police or some stupid stuff like that. I'm pro-police.
Yeah.
I'm pro-military. I'm pro-America. I'm just not anti-free speech.
Right.
You know, it's...
Right, and I still, I mean, to me, like, I just feel like, you know, I don't know how well it was thought through. I don't like, cause I mean, he does have a press conference. There's a quarterback battle going on. They want to talk to him after every practice. Well, I mean, he could have spoken on this. He could have made this the central part of his season in any time there's a microphone in front of his face without sitting. So again, I don't necessarily know how I even feel about that. But I the one thing is that I will fight to the end for him to be able to do it. You know?
Yeah, and the football side of this, Blaine Gabbert's never really impressed me as a quarterback.
No.
And I'm not following the league as closely as I used to, but it's very possible that Kaepernick could get thrown into the game.
Right.
And at a minimum, he said he's not sitting or he's not standing.
Yeah.
Until things change.
Yeah.
And I don't think things are changing anytime soon.
I don't think he's going to be
sitting, and that's going to be on TV every week.
Yeah.
It's not going away. This situation is not going away. So, I mean, there's a football component to it because, I mean, Chip Kelly now has to decide, is he going to put him in the game?
Right.
And Blaine Gabbert, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I'm a diehard Niners fan. I hope he does well.
Yeah.
But it might not happen. So
I also was thinking, like, you know, fans put up with a lot of stuff from players if they're delivering. And I kind of think what would be being said if Colin Kaepernick was playing at a level of like a Russell Wilson or a Cam Newton?
Oh.
What would people be as willing to cast him off? Because, I mean, I've seen a lot of people, he should be cut. And that's fine if that's your opinion, you know. But I wonder what the tone would be as far as, you know, people concerned about him losing his job, perhaps, you know, if the football aspect was razor tight.
Another aspect of this is Tim Kawakami kind of dropped a breadcrumb that Jed York is probably on Kaepernick's side right now on this particular issue. The 49ers immediately and swiftly, and he implied that York could have even written the thing, gave a press release in support of what his rights are.
Right. Yes, he did.
And so
very quickly, yes.
That, you know, that aspect of it is interesting because they pretty much trashed him in the media for an entire year and a half. And that's another thing that's at play here is when the organization goes and starts leaking things about guys, the fan bases, they start to turn on him.
Sure.
So to your point about if he was winning and, you know, this was a couple years ago and the Niners were four running plays away from a Super Bowl. What were they doing? I don't know. Anyway, all right, that's enough football talk. So in the NBA, is there anything other than Ty Lawson that's going on?
What do we have? We had the gold medal game happened since we've been gone. So America blew them out. Best game they played was in the gold game.
I will say DeMarcus Cousins, not getting enough credit for it, but he turned it around because they were struggling in that first knockout game. And his defense was off the charts.
They struggled in every game.
Yeah, but in the knockout round, they still blew teams out.
Who did they blow out?
I think everybody.
They only had the one good game. They barely got by Spain again, and then in the knockout, they barely got by Spain.
Probably right.
But anyway,
I'll be honest. I wasn't watching all of the Olympic action.
Right, but
the terrible analyst that I am.
Yeah, you know what are you gonna do? But yes, he was. I thought he played very well, with not a lot of stats. But I thought, like, watching him,
we're getting stories that are kind of like Bradley Beal and John Wall don't get along on the court.
Yeah, what was that? Is there anything to that thing?
I don't know. I mean, I think that you've got Bradley Beal as a scorer, you know, might want the ball more.
Yeah.
It's not like John Wall doesn't have the ball.
Yeah.
Too much. I mean, he had the ball so much that his efficiency went to garbage.
Yeah.
Last year. So I don't think he cares if he, you know, offloads some shot attempts.
Sure.
I thought that was, I don't know. I actually really didn't
reaching,
really.
Like,
that's my point was that
they saw each other at a restaurant maybe and they didn't say hi and someone's running with us or what?
Maybe John Wall's upset that they signed him to such a big deal.
Maybe.
I'm just purely making jokes now because I don't think that there's the point is there's nothing going on in the league. I mean, every story you read is like, you know, did Westbrook's Jordan ad take a shot at KD? You know,
what's that? Was that the one where he's like running on the airplane or whatever, or the runway?
I didn't see it. I mean, I guess the most interesting thing that happened in the last couple weeks is Tiber Pleiss.
Who?
The stretch five from Utah, 7'3", Tiber Pleiss, got traded to the Sixers. And you got a couple reports out of Salt Lake City a couple weeks ago that they weren't happy with Pleiss. And Pleiss is he's kind of built like Myers Leonard.
I've never heard of this person.
He's very tall.
Okay.
And he can shoot the three.
Okay.
He can move a little bit, but he still hasn't been able to put it all together. But I don't think there's really been a window to really accurately assess if he's done improving or if he can be something in the league.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, 7'3", you know, shooting threes. He's not Ofi.
Okay.
Whatever the step above Ofi
is. Where was he
is.
From?
Overseas. I forget where he
never
played.
Never heard of this person before.
I don't know his college or overseas background.
Yeah.
I just, you saw him get into the game every once in a while, especially when Rudy Gobert was hurt. And then he gets traded to Philly. So Philly, they got 2 second-round draft picks, as usual.
Mm-hmm.
And then they got some cash in the deal. And this was basically a way for Utah to get Joel Bolomboy onto the team. So they wanted to keep him as their 15th guy.
Okay.
And trading Pleiss more or less got that money off the books for them.
Nice.
So
do you think that, so what is this? So you got another big guy. Now, how many minutes was this Pleiss guy playing?
None. 3, 5, 8 minute stints, you know, that type of thing.
So what is Philly's plan here? Are they just going to experiment? They're going to leave him, develop him?
That's the thing I was thinking. I mean, there's been recent reports. What is going on over there? You hiccuping?
I've got this ear issue, and it's like I have water in my ear. It's been
I just took up swimming.
Yeah.
And don't let that go unchecked, man.
Really?
I have had water in the ear. I didn't know that you could, I didn't know what swimmer's ear was.
Okay.
So I've been swimming for about 4 weeks.
Okay.
5 weeks. It feels great.
Yeah.
Best workout ever.
Oh, that's good. Great on your joints.
Just the whole thing is awesome. But I had water in my ear for like 2 weeks, and then they started hurting. I mean, this has been your swimmer's ear update, but it's been, you got to get that looked into.
I'm going to.
But with Philly, with Pleiss, what I was wondering is, he makes a lot of sense because none of their guys can shoot.
Yeah.
And so if you can add shooting in general, anywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, they got a team that can't shoot.
They got a team that can't shoot. No space for the Wonderkin to do his job, you know, going to be your offense, is putting that kid in the point forward or whatever. Like.
I love talking about Philly now because the Sam Hinkie thing, like he doesn't get to see out his vision.
Sure.
They've got all these assets. Dario Saric turns into a pretty good player, pretty good asset. And now, you know, you've got Ben Simmons running the show with just no space.
Yeah.
I mean, we saw how defenders defended him in summer league of all places.
Yeah, they might as well been out. They might as well been below the baseline.
I've never seen anything like that, really. I'm trying to think of the last NBA player, Rajon Rondo, maybe.
Rajon Rondo. But
with Rondo, I don't think they gave him that much space.
Yeah.
It was an insane amount of space. I've never seen it.
Yeah.
So if you've got Nerlens Noel, you know, Jahlil Okafor, Simmons, they can't take Robert Covington off the floor at this point.
Yeah.
And Jared Bayless actually hit 41% of his threes last year. So
I like Bayless.
So your two guard positions can shoot, but it's not like, I mean, Bayless can pull off the dribble, so that's fine. And Covington's a dead eye out there. But it's not like they're going to be this expert team at getting three-point shots off.
No.
I mean, Covington's more of a catch-and-shoot guy than a off-the-dribble or, like, you know, aggressively running off of a screen to catch a ball on the run and shoot guy.
Yeah, I'm wondering, because even though, like, Okafor has some nice moves down there on the block, and I can't really remember Joel Embiid from Kansas, but I remember him.
Well, that's the other being decent here.
But like, are they good enough passers? I was watching, you know, I was watching a little 80s ball, and it was you know, watching Parrish and McHale work together and seeing their high lows. And I remember with you know, Pau Gasol and Bynum a few years back, both of those guys can really pass the ball, you right. know, and I and all, and same with Parrish and McHale. And I just, it's gonna be hard to make that thing work in that crowded an area.
So when I saw the Plyce deal, I was sitting there thinking, okay, I'm not trying to overvalue this guy at all, right. but if you wanted to add 10 minutes worth of shooting,
yeah,
you know, that's one way to do it. So then I thought to myself, do they have something in the cooker for a trade?
Yeah.
I mean, everybody knows they'd like to trade.
Yeah.
And they're playing that thing that NBA teams – or playing the game NBA teams do, but they're like, oh, we don't want to make a bad deal.
Right.
Well, you're going to end up holding the bag.
Yeah.
At the end of this, I'm not going to make a bad deal thing you're doing.
Right.
So I know. Well, there's so many of them. Look yeah. at Sacramento right yeah. now with Rudy Gay. Like, yeah. if you could have gotten a 15 to 20 pick.
You should have done that a long time ago.
That was – and now you're going to just sit there and hold on to him.
Yeah.
This is not – I mean, I don't know if there was a deal like that out there.
Yeah, I mean, you just wonder what their move is, because you got – I mean, you take Nerlens Noel off the floor, now you're – I mean, there are not a lot of good defenders on that team either.
Well,
like, we're talking about no shooting, and he's probably the only – well, Bayless now, those are probably the only two kind of defensive-minded guys.
I mean, you look at T.J. McConnell – I think he will end up being a fine shooter, but he can't step into a shot really. You know, he's not shooting at a high volume.
Right.
I mean, if he could, he would.
Right.
Gerald Henderson is not going to be shooting three-pointers anytime soon.
Right.
and then as you go further down the rotation, I mean, that Dario Saric is a guy that you would probably trust, you know, over a lot of them.
Couple out there, yeah.
Jeremy Grant can't shoot. He's a guy that I think really needs developmental minutes.
Yeah.
If he could ever just hit some of his shots.
Yeah.
He'd be good. And so, yeah, I mean, I just wondered with that, is there a trade in the works?
Yeah.
But then the report started coming out saying that they're probably going to waive him. And so, I mean, yeah, they got assets out.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
You can't really fault them for that. But, you know, maybe there isn't anything in the works. And that's been really the extent of the NBA news
yes.
that has hit. So you want to talk some fantasy here?
Let's take a break and then come back for some fantasy.
Are
we going to hit a take a break?
No.
No break?
No break.
Oh, what the heck?
Stat Boy says no break.
Oh, damn you, Stat Boy. All right.
So fantasy sports.
I love it.
We
want some more of it. I like it. I love it. I want some more of it.
Like many of you out there, Kaz does not play
fantasy basketball. I haven't been able to grasp that.
The fantasy basketball.
Yes.
So tell me, what about fantasy basketball, like, turns the non-fantasy basketball player off?
I think I don't want to make it sound simplistic or make myself sound bad, but I'm probably a little too lazy to pay that much attention to it. Because you got a couple of games a week, so you have to kind of be on top of your lineups every day. You know, it's not something that I feel if I'm going to put money out that I necessarily want to do. That might. I mean, I didn't think I wanted to do football fantasy either, and I love that. So I don't know. Maybe just not knowing. Not knowing, because I watch basketball as a like coach and a guy that's played. And so just because a guy, to me, I look at this guy's a good player, that doesn't mean that he's going to accumulate points on, you know, in a fantasy thing. So I think maybe just not knowing the rules and how you score is probably the thing that turns me off.
So let's say you were sitting with a fantasy expert.
Okay.
What would be the first thing you would ask them?
Like, if I'm going to take, like, who... Say I'm in the league and there's, you know, 10 guys, like who are the, like, what would be, who would be the five guys, who would be the top five guys to take?
Well, you'd have to buy my draft guide for me to tell you that information.
Okay. Let's just say you got a guy, like, his name is Shamond Grahams. And say you got another guy that's named... Schmanello Canthony. Like, like how valuable.
I hope you stick the landing on this one.
How do you, like, what's the, it would seem to me that Grames can do a lot of things. You know, he's going to get some assists. He's going to get some rebounds. He's going to score. He's going to block shots. He's going to get steals. Good field goal percentage. Actually, that's not a good comparison. Let's try like a Shimon Grames.
Shimon Grames. Okay.
So you got what do I call him? Canthony?
Schmanthony.
Schmello Canthony. Guy who can put the ball in the hole at a high clip. Would he be better? But to me, that's just one thing. You know, he doesn't shoot a good percentage. Would he be, would, like, say him in a Smushel guest book, who would be the guy to take out of those two?
Right now, the guy would be Schmushel. Schmushel Crestbrook.
Yes. Okay.
Because of the stats. I mean, I think the core of your question is more like, what am I doing here with the scoring?
Right.
Because in fantasy football, everything falls into one bucket. You get a certain amount of points for a touchdown. You get a certain amount of points for rushing yards.
Right.
And then at the end of the day, it spits out a number. And that number eventually is like 100 to 80.
Right.
Or something. Yeah. And there are fantasy basketball leagues out there that do that.
Mm-hmm.
But numbers are such a big part of basketball that I think there's just more numbers that are involved.
Uh-huh.
So, like, if you have points and rebounds and assists, that's three right there. And then if you have three-pointers and you have blocks and steals, that's another three right there. So now you're talking about six different categories of stats.
Uh-huh.
And they're all very different, whereas in football, it's about the kind of like the – it's all about yardage. That's like
right.
one thing to think about.
Right.
And the other is like how many catches do they have?
Right.
And then how many times do they get the touchdown?
Right.
So maybe like three different variables to think about. And
yeah.
in fantasy basketball, there's like right there, I just mentioned six of them. And then you can add turnovers and then percentages, field goal percentage and free throw percentage.
Now, are you talking about turnovers like steals, or are you talking about turnovers like if the player turns the ball over? Does that go
against
you?
If the player turns the ball over, and now what you've got is nine categories.
Right.
And the way that this game was actually modeled a lot off after fantasy baseball.
Mm-hmm.
Fantasy baseball was the first fantasy sport out there that people got into. And it's very math driven.
Right.
It is like
baseball, yeah, I would think. Yeah.
Well, baseball and basketball. The reason why I like fantasy basketball is that it's like a good half step between the pure, like, number driven madness of fantasy baseball, which has 162 games.
Right.
And a lot of different stats, and football, which is like, you know, really kind of simple in comparison to the other two.
Mm-hmm.
It's about halfway. It's got half the games, and then it's got half of the statistical kind of load, if you wanted to call it that. Keeping up on the numbers is half the battle.
So what about some of the more like a more intricate, like I'm trying to compare, like, say, like a guy like that does, I'm trying to think of like a one. Like, okay, so you got Kyrie Irving, smaller guard, so you know you're not going to get a lot of rebounds. Basically a scorer. You're not going to get
He blocks the ball at a high rate for a guy that's not known for his defense.
Okay, so say you have him, and then you have...
Random note to just throw in there.
Okay, but I'm trying to think of a player like a similar size, like, that basically just scores, you know? You could just look across the board and look at numbers, but what about like, does their the games, minutes, like how important are those stats as compared to just like across the board? What's the thing that's going to put that I got to go? These two guys put the same number. They basically do the same stuff. They rebound, assist the same way. Like, what's the thing that, like, I got to think about when I'm going to decide between these two guys?
Well, I think you mentioned in your last question that kind of is the basis of your the dichotomy of I watch this from a coaching perspective and a reality perspective, And how does that apply to the fantasy game? Because sometimes in fantasy football, fantasy baseball, fantasy basketball, bad players, and this is a good, this phenomena happens in the NBA no matter any way you look at it.
Right.
It's good or bad players, bad team, good stats.
Right.
And that thing, that happens in both scenarios, fantasy and reality.
Right.
But in fantasy basketball, the only thing that I've seen that doesn't really kind of line up is the steals and the blocks. Because somebody that goes for a lot of blocks, mm-hmm. a lot of times they're leaving the back door open.
Right.
And with steals, it's the same thing. It's a lot of gambling. Mm-hmm. Some coaches will highly penalize their players if they gamble a lot. And some of the schemes are just to stay home.
Right.
That will translate into less fantasy value. And that, but besides that one thing, I feel like fantasy basketball actually mimics the real thing pretty well. Like Kawhi Leonard is a guy that's out there. He's very highly rated in fantasy leagues because he's efficient shooting the ball.
Right.
And he does quite a few different things.
So you're saying if I just list, I'm just going to make my own list and I'm going to just go down. I could just start with who I think is the best player. I think I'm going to go LeBron, Kawhi, Steph, Durant, Westbrook, and I could just pick like that.
Yeah. Okay. Here's the thing.
Okay.
Now you get into the kind of stuff you get into with fantasy football. Sometimes injury prone players will go lower in drafts. And in football, that's a crazy concept because these guys are cracking each other over the head every week and there's only 16 games, so a 4-week injury is like a quarter of the season.
Right.
But you know, LeBron James will slip. You know, if your league has a playoff system, mm-hmm. where the end of the league basically is weighted heavily, mm-hmm. In a league where all the games are weighted equally, called a roto league, you might look at 10 games off and say, eh, you know what, that's not that big of a deal.
Sure.
That's only 1/8 of the production. But in a winner-take-all week, you know, that's why in football they look at schedules and they're like, oh, I don't know who the best defense is nowadays.
Right.
I'm terrible at fantasy football now. But I don't want to play that defense in the playoffs.
Right.
So people look at it that way. In fantasy basketball, certain guys might fall a little bit. Like LeBron's one of them. Mm-hmm. And players towards the end of their career might be more willing to give up the ball. Mm-hmm. But we know when it's the playoffs that LeBron James is going to turn it on.
Right, right.
Those concepts are in play. But if you just take your list as, like, I'm going to rank them how I see fit.
Yeah.
In reality.
Yeah.
And you line it up next to fantasy, it's going to be pretty similar. But with the caveats of steals and blocks.
So just so I could understand that steals and blocks thing, what you're saying is if you've got a guy that maybe gets a high volume of steals or a high volume of blocks, you have to be careful that he's not going to be benched a lot because the coach might be like, I can't have this guy on the floor.
You could have a really good defender that doesn't get a lot of steals and blocks.
Right.
Because they stay home.
Because they stay home.
And they don't gamble.
Right.
And that's the one thing. Where you might see like a Solomon Hill, his numbers in the steals and blocks categories were pretty low.
Yeah.
You know, players that are known for their defense but aren't really bringing steals and blocks to the table.
Right.
And why that's important is if you have 9 categories and they're all weighted equally,
right.
as they are in most fantasy basketball leagues, that's 2/7 or 2/8, depending on how many categories there are, of the game.
Okay.
So those people that don't – those categories can artificially fall if we're saying how are they rated in fantasy, how are they rated in reality.
Got it.
And that scoring system thing is, I think, the biggest thing that people, I know it was for me,
mm-hmm.
you know, many moons ago when I looked at this, I said, oh, you know, basketball is kind of complicated compared to football.
Yeah.
You know, there's more to it.
Right.
And it's more of a game in that respect that you've got to actually sit down and, but there's been some cool things in technology that have really made the math part of it kind of not completely go away, but there's a site called Basketball Monster out there where they'll plug in the numbers and tell you what these guys are all worth
right.
at the end of the day. And that makes it a lot easier for me.
I remember there was one year, years ago, I wasn't playing fantasy, but I remember like people talking about how great it was to have Jerome Bettis because like he was getting like 15 yards a game, but he'd have like always have a touchdown because he was the goal person. It was the goal line guy. So he finished the season with this insane amount of touchdowns, but he would only rush for like, you know, rushed for maybe 400 yards on the whole season or 300 yards or something like that. And it was like, but if you have a, if you were in a league where touchdowns were weighted super heavy, it was like awesome to have Jerome Bettis, even though he was crap on basically everything else.
And that was the thing about, there was fantasy baseball leagues that were roto, that were this complicated, you know, like 8-9 categories, and whoever wins in each category gets a certain score. And that's my favorite way to play, because it's to me the purest way.
Everything being equal.
Yeah, and if you've got a lot of money on the line, you want luck.
Sure.
you want as little luck involved as possible.
Right.
But when fantasy football came into prominence, the way they used to play it was touchdowns only.
Right.
The only thing that mattered was these touchdowns.
Yeah.
Probably because it took too long to score the game. If you open up a newspaper like everybody did back in the day, you would be looking to keep stats. And you're like, oh, I'm not keeping stats on all these categories.
Right. I mean,
who's got time for that? We'll just do touchdowns only.
Yeah, yeah.
Jerome Bettis, come on down.
Come on down, big boy.
We got time for one more question.
Do you take into effect, like, if I have two guys, how important would be, like, how good the team is? Do you look at, like, the Spurs, like, you have a choice between Powell and some other guy. Who would be big on a better team, or maybe on a worse team? Like, do you take into, like, the coaching patterns? Like, you know, down the stretch or throughout the season, Powell is going to get sat for God knows how many games. You know, that's just what Popovich is going to do.
It's a huge part of fantasy for the Spurs is these, and they've kind of gotten better in recent years, but these random, we call them pop DMPs.
Okay.
You're just, you didn't know what was going to happen. It's Thursday night. You know, it's a big TNT game, even though the league talked to him about this, and now he's going to try to stop doing it.
Yeah.
I'm resting all y'all.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff comes up. They're kind of an example of it because of the age of the players involved.
Right.
But, like, Orlando last year with Scott Skiles, he was a huge minute yanker.
Sure.
So, like, he's just taking guys and it's frustrating for the players. It's frustrating for the fantasy owners.
Right.
And you're looking at that and system changes. You're looking at pace changes. So, like, when George Karl comes in and the Kings run the number one pace in the league, that's impacting the amount of possessions they have. So that's impacting the amount of times they get to shoot the ball.
Right.
So if you're looking and you're doing this at an expert level, what you're doing is like, okay, these guys got 5 more shot attempts per game.
Right.
Who's going to get them?
Right.
And how does that work?
Yeah.
So coaching plays a huge role into it. And I think once you get past the scoring elements of it, it's like almost anything. You got to just kind of jump in head first. And then that stuff isn't quite as intimidating. Or you can set it up like a points league where you give those different categories different weights.
Uh-huh.
And then the score pops out at the end, 120 to 100. And nobody remembers the scoring as it's happening. And you just look at the screen and you're like, I'm winning.
Yeah.
Yes, I am winning.
Would you suggest speaking, say, like the Spurs, like, Would you avoid having more than one Spur on your team?
Not really. I never have been, in football, I never cared about that stuff. Like, people would be like, well, I don't want to have, you know, whoever Drew Brees is passing to, because I don't want to have one game where they all just suck.
No, I'm talking about as far as because he doesn't play them so randomly.
Yeah, I think the same thing still applies. Is you have to look at the players as individual assets.
Uh-huh.
And judge them based on that.
So you wouldn't like, so if you, your first pick that you got was Kawhi, you know, stat stuffer. And then, like, down the road, you had a choice between Tony Parker and somebody else that Tony Parker's probably clearly better than, but there's a good chance that Tony Parker is not going to play 20 games out of the season. Would you ever go with the less talented player just because he's probably going to give you more chances than Tony Parker?
9 times out of 10, and maybe even 99 out of 100, I'm going to take the more talented player and not worry about that, because I don't feel like, A, you can control for it,
mm-hmm.
but B, like, there's too many tangential, to make up a word.
Sure.
Tangential. things that can happen, and you just don't know at the end of the day if that's going to impact your league. So you just take the better player. What you can say, if like in football, I have shied away a little bit if like, you know, if it was like three or four of my key players in, and I knew like in week 14 in a playoff week, they were going up against a really bad defense for them. Mm-hmm. I might say, you know what, do I want to gamble my entire season on this particular trio?
Yeah.
And if the players are really equal, then I might say, okay, you know, don't have all the eggs in one basket.
Right.
But I'm really just against that methodology in general. Okay. You just take your best players and put them out there. Don't worry about it. If they all suck, they suck.
Yeah.
Probably not winning anyway.
Yeah.
If one of them does, so.
Right.
That's, that sure. You snuck in an extra question. And you're awake.
I've been known. I know. That was, I told you I was ready to go.
I did not believe this. I was expecting sleeping cause.
I meant to say earlier, we were talking about, Colin Kaepernick. I wish everyone listening could have seen Brewski as he was saying, as he struggled to get Colin Kaepernick out. He was concentrating so hard, I thought he was going to burst a vein in his head trying to not say Colin Kaepernick.
Somebody said his name was Colin the other day.
they were probably just ripping on him.
I don't know who was doing that. Colin Kaepernick.
Colin Kaepernick.
Colin. Losing it. go check out the if this fantasy stuff is something that sounds interesting to you now. Go
it
try
does.
It.
How do I get into the league? How do I? That's okay. That's a good question.
Tell me, Brew. How do I get into this?
I got, you know, I'm a big spender. I'm going to throw, you know, $100 down for an entire season. How do I go about getting into a league? Because I don't know anybody I can't get into your league because you're way too high end for me. And
we'll take your money.
But what if I want to get, how do I get into a league with a bunch of novice like myself?
Well, you can go to various websites like the big box site, CBS, you know, they've got, you know, you could just join a league. The money, the ROI on certain places is better than others. So if you're worried, like, you know, half of the league entry fees go to the winner and then the site keeps the other half. If you're playing with your friends, you're just going to go use a free software somewhere or maybe even pay a little bit to have a better software. Right now, I've been looking at FanTrax is a pretty good league commissioner software for those out there who are looking for one. There are sites where you can just sign up to play. Mm-hmm. And then if you go to various places, you could go to our message boards. You could go to other message boards out there and post that you're looking for a league. And find friends to play fantasy basketball with that way.
All right. I can dig it.
Yeah, I saw you yawning.
Well.
You couldn't make it. You ruined your perfect game. You already gave me
the go-ahead that I did a good job. And so then I took the... my guard down and the yawns attacked.
See,
again.
And that you can't praise anybody. You can't praise anybody.
You
give them some praise.
I'm like, who was that big dude? There was a guy in the Redskins like a couple of years ago that was like the next awesome big old defensive tackle, got like $100 million contract and just like came back just like 50 pounds overweight and never gave a damn, like Jamarcus Russell type, you know, thanks for the money, I'm cool now. Being an athlete, not my thing.
Supply and demand, baby.
Yeah.
Hey, you know what? It's not ideal. It's not maybe even right. But yeah, you know, you try not eating when you have $100 million. You do it. No, okay.
You try not eating 5 pizzas a day when you got $100 million in the bank.
That's pretty terrible.
I challenge you.
Check it out. If you're in a fantasy basketball, the draft guide, it's insane. I've done this for 10 years. It's the best one I've done. www.hoop-ball.com. My read-in school is really paying off.
Reading school?
They have a school for readings.
Do they?
No.
No.
No, Dan Bespris would not be happy with me right now. You can follow us online at www.kozandbrushow, facebook.com/kozandbrushow, Twitter!
Twitter!
K KOZANDBRU show. Another one's in the books.
Peace.